Can everybody hear that now?
Yeah.
Okay.
Does this tripod need to be in the wheelchair?
Yes, sorry. If it's a problem for you, might sit somewhere else. It's the camera on the screen.
Okay, to reiterate.
Can you come around and put your face in the camera? I didn't have a recording when we intro, so let people know who you are. Just wave in the camera.
Hi, my name is Lou Curtis, and I'm here for therapy. Okay. Now that we got the giggle stuff done.
No, there's more of that.
I was going to say done. Started.
Yeah.
Well, speak a little more and we'll find out because your voice goes a little bit.
He's going to turn it out. That'll solve it.
Testing 1, 2. Testing. Okay. As Anna said, let's see. Can I have my notes? Okay. That's fine.
I think these are right.
We did what we knew. Every group that moves from religion to relationship, from church to ecclesia, we start with what we know. If you know anything about homeschooling, it's the same way. Often homeschooling results in school at home instead of a new liberated open experience.
We still can't hear very well.
Yeah, that mic has to be close to your mouth.
Turn it up, please.
His beard's taken away.
Hello, testing. Yeah, I'm here. All right.
Keep talking, please.
So what we learned was that growth has nothing to do with headcount. That's the way churches work. You know, we're talking head count, we're talking body count, we're talking numbers of individual people. The more members you have, the more successful you are and that sort of thing. We also tried, because we were doing what we knew, conferences with a lot of speakers. It's a celebrity that brings people in the front door. And we had, you know, a lot of our conferences, that's what we use, or guest speakers. And, oh yeah, and we all brought our church backgrounds into Ekklesia. Because our religious church training, which could be anywhere from a few years to decades and decades, follows you around until you lose it over time. And I hope I'm not offending anybody when I say that, but this is an ecclesia, not a church. We're about relationship and not religion. And so when we brought our church background, I like to talk about it in terms of what happens to a coal miner when they get out of the mines. They'll come out on Friday, they'll take a shower, and start their weekend. And by Saturday morning, their skin is dark because coal dust is still coming out of them. So they'll bathe again. It takes weeks, if not months, for their bodies to get rid of that. It's the same way with our spirits and souls. As religion weeps out of us and seeps out of us, and we get rid of it. All of us in this community began with the experiences that we had in religion as we walked into relationship, which our dear Miss Subi here likes to say is off our grid. There's no reference for it. You're not bothering with theology. you're doing what you can with what you've got and being open to the fact that things are going to be different. So Father's teachings to us really got strong in 2017, 2018 when he began to lead us into small. This is small. This is nice. Ekklesias typically are small because they meet in homes. And if you get to 12, between 12 and 20 people, it's time for a new ekklesia to break off. They're small. He led us into intimate. It's really tough for, and I'm not putting them down or anything, I'm just simply saying a fact. It's difficult to have intimacy with 60 people, 300 people, 600 people. You cannot have intimacy with them. It doesn't happen. It's a big crowd sitting there receiving what's given to them. Ekklesia don't work that way. He led us into intensive. So that what happened for us was that our experiences being relational became intense. Oh, how do I put this? They became intense partially because of what I call head ripping. It was, you know, tearing off our old paradigms, opening us up to new ones. And then there's all the spiritual stuff that so many theologists will tell you, well, we don't have miracles anymore. We don't see in spirit. You're into new age. How many of you heard these kind of things? Yeah. You're a heretic. He also led us to growth in depth and in maturity, not in numbers or headcount, as I said. Growth has to do with depth, driving a taproot. All good, strong, healthy ekklesia are driving a taproot with Father God. They're not going wide and shallow. They're going few and deep. That's one of the big differences. This gathering is the living, changing, growing ekklesia. What you're going to experience in our time together is something akin to ekklesia. We haven't rehearsed all this. We started 25 minutes late. It's organic. It's natural. We roll with it, you know. And so the growth that each of us makes as individuals has to do with the relational aspects of the ekklesia in terms of our love for Father God and our love for one another. This gathering is a people brought together by a passionate love of God. I don't know about you, but my decades in the theologist, institutional, organized religion church had no real love of God. It was talked about. Everything was talked about. Everything was spoken of in terms of theology. And again, if your experience is different, I'm not putting it down or telling you what to believe or do. I'm just saying this is what happened to me. This gathering is a people brought together by the love of God. And we have a passionate love for one another. One of the things that I drove this community nuts with was about 2 years ago, I kept telling them, I kept saying, I have never experienced so much love. I mean, real, honest love. Yeah, you'll find we're a bunch of huggy nutcases, which is great. But we honestly love one another. We grieve together. We celebrate together. We bear one another's burdens and one another's victories. It's just all part and parcel of working together, of moving together, of being an organism. Yeah, this is really important. We're not spiritual gurus. I'm not standing up here because I've read a whole ton of books and gone to schools and have letters after my name and all that stuff. We're not spiritual gurus at all. Most of what we'll share with you is based on our own experiences and in some cases, stuff we've read and learned from other mentors. So we don't have all the answers. And in fact, it's been my experience that answers are not what this is all about. Relational faith with Father God and one another is not about having answers. That's what a theologist does. And I remember being one of those people who thought that way and lived that way. And I was always, I was always looking for answers to things. So, as our friend and mentor, Mike Parsons, says in England, don't take my word for it. Don't take anybody's word for it. Seek your own revelation with Father God. And this is one of the toughest things that some people who are coming out of religion and into relationship have. Well, God won't talk to me. I can't approach God. I'm sorry, but something happened when Christ gave up his ghost. Anybody tell me what it is? The curtain in the temple was torn from top to bottom. Why? That was the boundary between the temple, inner temple, and the Holy of Holies. And if you went in, as you may recall, if you went into the Holy of Holies without all the cleansing and all the things that had to be done, you were a dead duck. Not kidding. Guess what? That doesn't count anymore. Thank you, Levi. That doesn't count anymore. Each one of us who carries the indwelling Holy Spirit of Father God, given to us through Christ himself, through his death and resurrection, you can go in and sit at the foot of the tabernacle in there. You can go in and sit at the foot of the Ark of the Covenant. He wants us as individuals in there. Direct relationship. So go get your own revelation. And if you are not accustomed to seeing in the Spirit and speaking to Father God, there are a bunch of us around here who can help you in that, guide you in that.
Oh.
Okay.
Oh.
I waited too long. See, I didn't touch the little thing. So, the bottom line is, trust Father God. We'll tell you the truth as we know it, but it isn't always God's truth. Am I making sense? Okay? Yeah. Okay. We're not gathered here to load us all up with information. Ian Clayton likes to say, you're not here to get goosebumps on your goosebumps. We're not. This isn't about what's up here. Shut it off. It's irrelevant. This is where we're dwelling in our time together, in here, in our soul, in our spirit, not in our brain. We're not here to sit and receive. You're going to be standing. Some of you are going to be enjoying flags. A few of you are going to enjoy some of the musical instruments over here, the percussion. Some of you are going to sit at the back tables and draw. It's active participation. This is one of the differences between religion and relationship. Remember, we do relationship. We don't do that religion thing. Growth, I'll go here. We're not here to grow in mere knowledge and information. So it's not a case of, yes, I read these four books on whatever, and I know all about it. That's irrelevant. It's got nothing to do with anything. How is that relationship? It's not. We are here to, and I kind of like this slide because I envision that little ball of light as the Holy Spirit. We are here to share Father's insights and revelations. We are here to actively experience the presence of Father God. I'm going to let you in on a little dream prayer that I've had for a few weeks now. I have been asking Holy Spirit to show up as a wind, just as he did at Pentecost. I'm asking him in one heavenly way or another to be here in that kind of force so that we can know again, afresh, something that we lost 1,700 years ago and to have a second Pentecost. You'll be hearing me talking about a second Renaissance that's going on, and it's kind of related to that. Actively receive blessings and insight. That's what we're here for. Mealtimes are great because we all get to sit and talk with each other. You get to sit and ask questions about things and share your insights and your testimonies with one another. Oh, yeah, we're going to actively grow in our relationship with Father and with one another. That's what we're here for. We're here to receive the seeds of exponential growth. Okay, we have an unofficial motto here. I don't know if Anna knows this one or not. Oh, she does. We never do for another person what they can or should do for themselves. Never. Jesus never did that. He never ran around doing something for someone on a repeated basis. What did he do when he healed someone? He said, go and sin no more, or some other kind of thing. For example, we don't pray for people. We get individual requests or group requests. Will you pray for me? No. I know that might sound hard, but that's religion. Relationship says, I will pray with you. I will be in agreement with you. I will enter the presence of the Holy Spirit with you. But you're the one who is in need of prayer. And you're the one who needs to be on point. As an ekklesia, all that we do and become is organic. This is organic. We started 25 minutes late. That's an example of organic, okay? We don't have scripts. We have an itinerary we're going to kind of stick to. We don't have scripts. We don't say, what is it you talk about? A sermon, three songs, and a prayer?
Offering.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, okay. We don't do that kind of thing at all. It's organic. And it's organic for a bunch of reasons, one of which is so that growth occurs after a session stops, after a session is completed. Does that make sense? You are organic. I am organic. Our relationship is organic. It's all natural. Boy, does this require patience. We don't sit down in a little back room and beat our heads on a table saying, oh, we got to come up with a plan. We got to do that. We got to think about it. We don't do that. We ascend. We ask Father God, what's your plan? What's your desire? What's on your heart? because that's what we want to work with. It's also intimate. I think this week you're going to see some people praying together. You're going to see some people healed. You're going to see all kinds of things in which we are intimate one with another. And it's spontaneous. There may be a certain item of an agenda on the piece of paper here, but it may also turn out to be something rather different. And as with all Ekklesia, because we haven't done this for 1700 years, thank you, Constantine. And he wasn't the only one. He's the one we blame. But we haven't done this for 1700 years. We're figuring this stuff out. And we know that for us to simply jump back to a first century model all by itself is folly. This is the 21st century. My point is that things are different today. There can be essential similarities beyond that. This is a different age. It's a different era. We think different. We value different. And there's a heck of a lot more of us in this world. So, welcome to Gathering 2019. We are honestly glad that you're here. Thank you.
You can leave it up. It's cute.
Okay.
So it actually stays up.
Sorry. You just slide it up and it's on.
Give me a minute here.
Can you hear me now? Yeah. Ooh, that looks cool too. Leave that there. I don't have a PowerPoint.
I don't know if that's patented or not, et cetera, et cetera.
Oh, I see. So. You don't want to get in trouble with the crazy pictures that we shouldn't. As Anna already said before, first of all, can you hear me? Can you hear me now? Can you hear me now?
Really? Use your stage voice.
Use my stage voice?
Yeah.
Is that my stage voice?
The one that you always use.
This is my teacher voice, which I used to say all the time. Okay, and I'm just going to kind of stand in front of the camera because I don't have a PowerPoint presentation for this.
Go that way.
Go this way?
Go. Closer.
There you are.
This way.
Perfect.
There you go.
Yeah.
Now you're out. Just play hot and cold. Yeah. Do you want me in or out? I want you in the picture, but not too far back. So take two steps back. Stop. There. We need a little red circle that I can stand on.
Step to your right, please. More. Thank you.
Oh.
Okay. As I said before, my name is Ellen Horn. I am on the governmental bench for Northwest Ecclesia. And again, Anna will tell you a little bit about that later. My part in this, I started this journey and was on it for 2.5 years before I knew other people who did it. You know, I had to do this by myself, and I have run into so many people who have not had anybody to walk them through it. I had Ian Clayton teachings, I had my Parsons, I had all these others, and I would go and find the YouTube videos. At the time, I was teaching at a university that I had a 9 o'clock class, and then I had another class that didn't start until 3. So I'd sit in my office and listen to teachings. I'd shut my door unless a student needed to come see me. And every day, all of that time, I'd sit there and listen to teachings. But that's where it is. I mean, that's where we tend to let it stop. We listen. I took notes. How many of you have seen my notebooks? They're all tapped. Every teaching that I have, I tap. You know, I can see seven spirits of God, and I take all these notes. And at the end of every one of them, I would come up with an activation that I could do to practice. But I did that on my own, simply because I knew, you know, some of you may or may not know about me, but I am a professional musician, my trade. I'm a classically trained musician. I have spent my entire life being a musician.
my main instrument is clarinet, and that's what I teach now at the college level. So I have music majors as well as non-music majors, and I've taught pretty much every music course that you can possibly imagine at the university level, except for I won't do composition. I'll teach theory in ear training, but I'm like, no, I don't want to do comp. My 18th and 16th century counterpoint aren't so great, and I have to refresh my memory on those. But the whole point is, as a musician, what do? You get good at your instrument.
Practice.
It's the P word, which takes patience and perseverance. So if you don't practice with patience and perseverance, what I call the three P's, I have that on my studio wall. I have two sayings on my studio wall. One, don't play like a weenie. And two, practice takes patience and perseverance. And a student walks into my studio and they play like a weenie, all of you points at the sign. It's a picture. One of my students made it Squidward, you know, with a red circle around it, you know, Squidward plays the clarinet. A little circle but with a red line, and I just point. And they roll their eyes. And the other one, patience takes practice and perseverance. And I joke with my students, I have spent more years in practicing than you are alive. So how can we expect to practice kingdom stuff unless you practice? We can't become kingdom people and function from heaven to earth first unless we practice. And that was inherently built into me because of my years of being a classical musician. If anyone has ever studied classical music, you spend a lot of time practicing your fishy things. Fishy things, anyone know what those are?
Scales.
Fishy things. Okay. I seriously had a student for a whole year. He never knew what I meant. He walked into his last lesson and finally figured out why you call them fishy things. I said, it took you this long. So, to get really good, you have to do the same thing over and over and over. What is making my fingers move?
Muscles.
Muscles. So you have muscle memory. So to do anything, if you go to the gym and you work out, you have to do the same motions over and over and over. For what reason?
Muscle memory.
So we're exercising our spiritual muscle when we practice. So, and because I would sit in my office and I would literally take notes and all these things. And some of you can see my notebook. I think I'm on my fifth notebook. And now I have where you can pull the pages up, stick new pages in, so I don't have to start another notebook. And I took every teaching that I had and made an exercise out. And practice and practice and practice. The first 6 months of practicing seeing in the spirit, I did exactly what Ian Clayton said. I would do it at 10 o'clock at night. I would turn off the lights, I would go lay in my bed, put on my music, and pray in tongues for a while. I mean, I can sing and pray in tongues for like 6, 7, 8 hours at a time because I do it all the time. And I would start doing that, and first of all, I'd see flashes, and then I would see, and it took me a while. And we tend to say, oh, I tried it twice. I guess I'm not gifted in that. Seeing in the spirit and participating as a kingdom person is not a gift. It's what we're supposed to do. That is part of when we are working in Ekklesia, that's how we function, is from that position. We're functioning from heaven to earth instead of earth to heaven, which is the normal way that most people have done it, is from earth to heaven instead of heaven to earth. And so it's really all about practice, of which you're going to hear me do a session on that, and how we take our trials and our tribulations and we turn them into something absolutely bodacious. There's my word. I got that out there first and foremost. You get to hear that a lot. It's my favorite word. One of my favorite words. So my thing in this is it was all about candidacy. If we do it for the purpose of building intimacy with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, we're going to rock it. Because that's what it's about. If you go into the kingdom realm and you ascend and you're staying in the Spirit, if your goal 100% of the time is to build intimacy, everything else falls into place. And that was hammered into me. I mean, when I, the first time I heard Ian Clayton, I'm sure some of you have been in the same place, you're just like, oh. And it is a, but in my spirit, I knew that what he was saying was right. It was, he was the first person who actually answered questions I had for 30 years that no one even tried to give me an answer to. Mike Parsons was the same thing. So I knew, and so even though it was going over my head, I still listened, practiced, put it into me as part of what I did on a daily basis. Because this is part of kingdom living, is you have to practice and then put it into you. And again, it's all about intimacy. I go up, sit in my heart garden, do all these things, expecting, oh, we were going to talk about this. No. Then I find out later what we were doing had everything to do with that. So what we just have to pretty much throw all of our expectations out the window. You know, there's a song that goes with that, but I'll sing it later. I have lots of cheesy songs. I used to teach elementary music, so I know every cheesy song in the book. I'm just going, please don't sing.
Yeah.
Anyway.
Kind of like your beer one.
No. That one's for later. You have to be singing, you have to sing Gold Vandals first.
After
then you sing. Anyway, so as we are going through this whole week, the whole point is practice. If you hear something, make an exercise out of it. And if you don't know how to do it, have someone help you with it. But the more we practice, the more we practice, the more we practice, the more we practice, that intimacy, everything comes from that. If that is our main goal, then everything else falls into place. And I am not the same person I was even 2 weeks ago, but think about 6 years ago when I started this journey. It's like, dude, I'm not even anywhere close to the same person. I was sick, and I don't do sick. Sick is not something I like to do, but I had just come out of an abusive marriage, and my body was not happy. So I had to work through all of that. So we're going to walk you through some of our own journeys. We are going to learn how to ascend. We're going to learn how to build that intimacy in a deeper level than any of us ever thought. And because I'm almost done, but I'm going to give, because I'm quick, like a rat. Sorry, I have a hunch. So you see all these bodacious musical instruments up here and over there. So when you come back for the afternoon session, if you have instruments, bring them. If you don't think that you are talented enough to play a musical instrument, that's the first paradigm to get rid of between now and then. Because, you know, as an elementary teacher, every child in that room was able to play a musical instrument. So if you think you're not talented, you're probably wrong. Because someone told you that a whole long time ago that you could never play a musical instrument. So just think about that. So if you've got something, bring it. Because I'm going to talk to you about a new style of worship that I was working on with another group before I knew about North Coast Ecclesia, and they were working on it simultaneously at the same time. And we're like, We get together and we realize we're doing it. It's not your normal, everyday way of doing worship. So we decided that we're going to walk you through. Again, Luce talked about it being a participatory event. Kingdom work is participatory. There are no, I'm going to go sit in the back corner and.
We will come and get you.
Jim.
And love on you.
Yes. Lots of hugs. So I'm super excited about this week and getting to know some of you more. I mean, I know a lot of people here, but there's a lot of people I've never met. So this time, so we're super excited that you're here. And on that note, lovely. I was being very punny. Okay, so I think that's the only thing I have to say about this afternoon. Come with instruments. I'm not going to give you any more hints, and I'm going to turn it over to Anna, Anna, Mabana, 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 Mabana. Left, left.
Right.
It's
right. Good. Perfect.
Oh boy, this first recording is just going to be absolutely wonderful. People are going to watch it and go, what the heck? Anyway, so as you know, I'm on Wingate. This has been quite a journey. We did the first gathering in 2014, and it was in this room, and it was standing room only. It was packed up. And it was great fun. Everybody had community, all those kinds of things. 2015, we invited Mike Parsons, and I was so disappointed. Oh, I was so disappointed.
Well done.
30-some people showed up. Guess what? That was the Deep, called the Deep Conference, that we have on our YouTube channel, and he has on his. And like 50,000 people have watched it. So just because there's a few people at the conference itself doesn't mean it doesn't have people there. So 2017, we invited Praying Medic and Michael Danforth and Mike Parsons again. And some of the speakers then were like, oh, get a big place. You're going to pack out 500-600 people. Had 170 people, and we were so in debt. So it was scary in debt. And you know, the Lord, he does wonderful things. And a whole lot of the debt was canceled out. And people gave us money. And we have one small debt that we're still paying off. And we have an agreement with them, and they're happy. But then what Lou said, after when 17 happened, the Lord started saying, small, small, small. And every year we were making it smaller and smaller. So this year, we thought we would have Dr. O and Nancy Cohen. Well, Dr. O writes us and says that he realized he had a commitment to somebody else in the Northwest first, and that he, ethics and responsibility, he should keep his commitment to them before us. So he canceled. And then Nancy, it was just a lot of miscommunication, and we never worked things out. And it was December, and we're like, what are we going to do? We're going to have guest speakers. And we got together, and we ascended, and we prayed, and we had some dreams, and the Lord said, you do it. And I went, who listened to me? And the Lord said, you need to repent of that. I'm like, okay. And then I was talking to a friend, and I said, man, this is a hard swallow for me. And she said, what are you talking about? You guys are cutting edge. You do stuff that other people don't even think is normal. And I'm like, okay. And then we started working out the budget for this year, and 50 kept coming out. 50. We thought we'd plan for maybe 100. And I said to the gang, I think we're almost just a plan for 50. And so here we are. That's, we made space for 50, and that's it. So you're in for an adventure. I think the same thing that happened in 2015 is going to happen here. I think the impact is going to spread farther than here. So as a real confirmation, we went to England, Del and I. That was an experience, one I wasn't expecting. It happened to Del way more than me. But she must have had 6-10 people a day go, I know who you are. You're Del Hummelford. I listen to your music. I bought your music. And the same thing for me. People would walk up and go, more and more, what's easier? I've been on your website. I've watched your YouTube channel. And that was an absolute affirmation to me that we're heading down the right road. So, filling in the holes for you a little bit. That's how we came to this. So I'm going to say it again. You're in for an adventure. This is how it's going to go. It expands. We're going to start with you.
We're going to start with what skills, tools, protocols will help you mature. We're going to go from you personally into community and how to relate in community and what ecclesia really looks like, because you hear the word thrown around a lot. People have partial definitions. Some people use it as organized church. But we're going to tell you about our experiences of living in it and how God has expanded it to us. And then we're going to take you into kingdom government and the coming move of God, and you get to carry that home and decide how you fit in there and what you want to do. So, the model for this is completely different than anything you've been through. Anybody ever heard of a dump and run? You know what a dump and run is?
Okay. A dump and run?
A dump and run. It started 300 years after Christ died, when the Catholic Church was formed and the priests stood up and pontificated. That's their word. And that's all there was. You were given some words and you went home. Then, in the 1300s, Italy, the universities in Italy, the universities in Paris, and the universities in London started lecture speaking to teach instead of hands-on, because they could talk to more people. It's a dumping run. They filled people up, let them out the door, didn't have them physically do anything. See what I'm getting at? As far back as 2016, I kept thinking, there's something missing, there's something missing. Because our conferences were not like what we do when we meet together in fellowship. They were dumping runs. So every session here has an activation, an ascension. You are going to be community. You are going to participate with one another. Some of it you may think is absolutely wacky, but I really encourage you to try it. And I think you will go home with your minds blown.
Yay!
Yeah. So, the only other thing I can say is a little bit about me. I have a passion for ecclesia, you'll find that out. But I also have a passion for the kingdom life. Now here's the catch about kingdom living. Betty? It requires wholeness. Just organically, I got into healing sessions. It wasn't anything I planned. But in all reality, I call them wholeness sessions, because what you find out is you're wandering a path with someone. And when people come back and back and back, you're wandering a path through their life. I have a friend, Steve Harmon, you may know him. He is our most searched out YouTube playlist, his teachings. He says, if we were all healed and whole, we'd be just Jesus. And that's why I call it wholeness. We're trying to get to being just like Jesus. And in that, we live the ascended life. We learn kingdom living. And when you do that, you start seeing your identity and purpose, and we hope we can help you with that. If you don't know your identity and purpose, we help you. We hope we can help you fulfill that. And we have seen it in the core of the ecclesia, you know, Lou's visual artist and writer. Levi is artifacts. We'll look at some of his stuff around the room. Miss Laura is a healer, a major healer, and lives with severe physical pain and keeps going and is believing God. You know, how many times have you met that, a healer who has this wonderful ministry and lives in physical pain themselves? That's Laura. Paulette is called to the nations, and she's fun to wander off with.
We're going to Puerto Rico to teach the Ekklesia there in a month, a little over a month. Miss Lizzie at the back table. I would say Miss Lizzie is our cosmos person. If you want to go strange places in the spirit, find Lizzie. And while you're at it, she'll give out the plants. And then we told you about Dell. Sue will tell you she's a theater person, but I'm going to tell you that she's a consummate teacher. Sue is an exceptional teacher and does a lot of her mentoring sessions. So with that, we're going to let you go 15 minutes late. We're going to set up the rest of the music. You guys have a good time at lunch. See you back here at 2:15. Now, the wonderful thing about 2:15, absolutely 2.
It would be nice to be on time. 2.
Okay. I'm thinking if they can't get to their lunch in time,
that's okay.
We won't spank them if they're in at 2:15. Is that okay? But be here at 2.
The activation.
2. So this main drag right here, if you guys don't know, all the restaurants are on this main drag. You can just walk down this street and find something to eat.
There's a list in your packet.
Yeah, and there's a list in your packet. Anyway, you're free.